Dear students, welcome to Tungala online classes. Today we will discuss the economic importance of bryophytes. The previous video we had discussed the general characteristic features of bryophytes and their respective classification, and so now we shall start with the economic importance of bryophytes. Right? These bryophytes are economically important and even they are biologically very important, right? The first economic importance of these bryophytes is ecological succession. So this is more important aspect you must remember. See here, these bryophytes, already you know, they grow on the rocks itself. They grow on the rocks, and these bryophytes usually they are growing on the moist places already I have mentioned. So some of themselves are xerophytic in nature also, right? So and such kind of bryophytes which grow on this rock release some of the chemical components. They release some of the chemical components that withers the rock into soil, right? Withering of this rock that take place, and ultimately the soil formation starts. When the soil is formed, that moment the higher plants start to grow there, and ultimately what happens, so the entire rock is being converted into what? So soil place. So there on that many number of the plants that can grow. So that area, that rocky area, that ultimately becomes what? A forest. And that kind of process itself is said as ecological succession, what we call it as. And these are the initiator plants which are responsible for the formation of the forest, right? So by converting the rocky place into forest itself. So that's why this is more so biologically important process of these bryophytes. This is one economic importance. And the second economic importance is they prevent soil erosion. Prevention of soil erosion. Right? Prevention of soil erosion. So soil erosion is prevented. Why? Because so there these plants are growing as if a sheet on the ground. So when they grow as if a sheet on the ground in mass, so it avoids the soil erosion itself. So this is also another economic importance of what? These bryophytes. And third one, so these plants, especially sphagnum, I had given the example, right? So this moss plant which has good water retention capacity, so it absorbs water and keep the water with the plant itself. So that kind of water retention capacity this plant has, right? Which is the name of the plant? Sphagnum, right? So this holds the water for long period. Since it holds the water for long periods, it is more useful during the transportation of the plantlets or the seedlings. So from one place to another place, if you keep, so along with those small plants, this sphagnum, so then it provides water for those so plants. And even so the cuttings, what we call them as, those cuttings are also kept moist by this sphagnum itself. So this is also one more use of or the economic importance of these bryophytes. So they have good water holding capacity. So in nurseries usually sphagnum is used, right? And next one, peat, very important one. What is this peat? So there is moss plant, so like a sphagnum, which grows in acidic marshy areas. So when it grows there, after thousands of years later, it becomes as if a fossil, right? And it becomes a large block like structure, right? So large sheet like structure it becomes in the underground. So there in marsh area, after thousands of years, so this plant or the moss plant is removed and it is cut into several block like structures, and each block is acting as fuel. It is used for fuel purpose. It is used as fuel itself, right? So that is also called as a spongy mass of the plant itself is called as what? Peat, right? And that peat is used as fuel. Peat is used as fuel. And next one, so these are used as a food sources. Usually in a rocky places or in colder region where the ice blocks are present, so there these plants are growing usually. So there these plants are the best source of food for many number of birds. Many number of birds as well as cattle even, right? So that is why it is used as food for many number of animals in rocky places. So why? Because in rocky places there is no possibility of growth of the higher plants. That's why. So these become the main source of food there, right? So these are some of the economic importance of these bryophytes. One more is there, polytrichum. You know the polytrichum. So this is also one of the best example for moss plants, right? So if you prepare tea with the help of this, by taking this polytrichum, so that is the best medicine, right? What it is used as? Medicine. What is used here? Polytrichum is one of the bryophytes, so which is used for making the tea. So hence it is used for dissolution of kidney or gallbladder stones, right? So this is the medicinal importance what these plants have, right? So this is all about the economic importance of these bryophytes. Next group of plants is pteridophytes. Now the next group of plants is pteridophytes. So let us go through the general characters of pteridophytes and their respective classification. Okay. General characters of pteridophytes. General characters of pteridophytes. So before this one, so let us know some of the things related with this pteridophytes. Pteridophyte is a term which is coined by Haeckel. Haeckel is the name of the scientist, the one who termed pteridophyte, right? So, and these pteridophytes are commonly known as seedless vascular cryptogams. Seedless vascular cryptogams. So is very important feature of these plants. See here, so these do not bear any seeds. So they do not bear any seed. Hence they are seedless. Vascular. These are the first vascular plants. These are the first vascular plants. Why these are called as first or primitive vascular plants? These are called as because so these plants have vascular bundles or vascular tissues. So for the first time, these land plants that show the presence of vascular tissues like xylem as well as phloem. These are the two tissues which are seen in these plants for the first time. So hence these are said to be as the first vascular plants. So these are terrestrial in nature. They are purely terrestrial in nature. And these plants are the vascular plants since they are consisting of xylem as well as phloem. Xylem helps in water conduction of the water, and phloem helps in conduction of the organic food material. This is the fact, you know it better. And these xylem as well as phloem are primitive in nature. How they are? They are primitive in nature. So this xylem vessel do not have, it doesn't consisting of, so true xylem vessels. They do not consisting of true xylem vessels, and phloem do not consisting of any companion cells. Companion cells are totally absent over here, as well as true xylem vessels are absent over here. Hence these vascular tissues are said to be as primitive vascular tissues. So first vascular plants, these are called as, it shows us, okay. So this is the fact what we should know, right. So then where do you find these plants? Where do you find these plants? Means what? Occurrence. So usually these are growing. They are growing in moist, shady and dampy places. So these plants are usually growing in a moist, shady, so dampy places, right? So such kind of plants which are pteridophytes, okay. So this is the occurrence of these plants. And now we'll go through the plant body. Plant body. How is the plant body in these plants? See here, so these are the plants in which plant body is differentiated into root, stem as well as leaves. Okay, so the plant body is differentiated into roots, stem as well as leaves. Okay, so this way the plant body is differentiated over here. So let us see diagrammatically. Now you are observing the plant body here. So this is one best example for, this is one best example for the pteridophytes, that is Selaginella, and another example is Lycopodium. This is Lycopodium, this is Selaginella. By seeing these two plants, so let us explain the plant body. So especially these plants are sporophytes. Why? Because it is the dominant plant. So it is a dominant plant, photosynthetic one, and it is independent one, right? So this sporophytic plant, this is sporophytic plant. So where the plant body is differentiated into leaf like rows of leaves that you are seeing on the axis and the stem as well as, so what, roots, rhizoids, they are nothing but roots. This way plant body is differentiated into three major parts. One is roots, stem as well as leaves, right? So and the plant body is sporophytic plant which produce spores. Let us see what is the unique feature of this one. Rows of leaves are seen over here. In some pteridophytes the leaves may be smaller and in some others the leaves may be larger, right? So based on that one, leaves of pteridophytes may be smaller in size and larger in size. Smaller leaves are called as microphylls. These are called as microphylls. Larger ones are called as megaphylls. Right? So these are called as megaphylls. Micro, the name itself suggests smaller leaves, and mega means larger leaves. Leaves are larger. So microsporophylls are usually seen in, so the examples like Lycopodium as well as Selaginella. So where the leaves are smaller and larger one, so the best example we can quote over here, all kinds of ferns, Dryopteris, only pteris is example for that one, Marsilia. So these are the best examples for what? So megaphylls, right? Megaphylls are mainly seen in ferns, and these pteridophytes are commonly known as what? Ferns itself, right? So next one. And there are some specialized leaves. See here, so one compactly arranged leaves are over here at the edge of this branch, right? Even here also you are observing here compactly arranged specialized leaves, and those specialized leaves are bearing the spores. Hence those leaves are called as sporophylls. What they are known as? Sporophylls. So leaves are compactly arranged to form cone like structure or strobilus, it is called as. See here, so this is called as cone, this is called as cone in Lycopodium. So like this they make the cones. So some leaves, specialized leaves, they make a compact body, slender body itself, and that body itself is called as what? Cone or strobilus. And these leaves bear what? Spores. Hence these are called as what? Sporophylls. What these are commonly known as? Sporophylls. Sporophylls means what? These are spore bearing leaves. Sporo means spores, phylla means leaf. Leaves which bear spores on them are called as sporophylls, right? And one more thing, these leaves which produce spores, I said, right? Here, spores are present in the sporangium. That kind of many number of sporangium are present on these specialized leaves, right? And those are said to be as sori, right? What is the point? Yeah, sometimes leaves bear sporangium, many number of sporangium those sporangiums together form what? Sori. Right? Sori. Sporangium itself is present over here. They are called as sori. Right? Such kind of many sori are present. In sporangium, what are present? Spores are present. Hence, these leaves which bear spores are called as sporophylls. Right? They make one compact, slender, cylindrical body, and that is called as what? Cone. Inside the cone, leaves are present. Right? So, on the leaves, what are present? Sporangium are present. Sporangium contains spores. This is the fact of what you should very clear get. Okay, so this is how the leaves are present and which bear the spores. And sometimes the leaves are bearing two types of spores. And sometimes the leaves are bearing only one type of spores in specialized species of these pteridophytes. Okay, let us see the leaves which bear only one type of spores. They are called as homospores. What they are termed as? Homosporous plants. And so different type of spores, right? They are called as heterosporous plants. Means sometimes the leaves may bear small sized spores. They are microspores, and those leaves which bear microspores are called as microsporophylls. And sometimes the leaves bear larger spores, right? And such kind of spore bearing leaves are called as megasporophylls. This way, based on the type of spores which are borne on the leaves are called as microsporophylls as well as megasporophylls. Now, microsporophylls and megasporophylls. So like this, there are two types of leaves that we come across over here. One thing I should say, one examples for these two are given in NCERT book. So homosporous means only one type of spores are born on the particular leaves. They are said to be as what? Homosporous leaves. So homosporous species of plant it is said to be as. So the best example I shall quote over here, Lycopodium. Lycopodium is one Dryopteris is another example. These are the two examples which are for homosporous plants. And heterosporous plants, right? So, Salvinia as well as Selaginella. Example for heterosporous is examples. Salvinia and Selaginella are the best example for heterosporous leaves. And microsporophylls as well as megasporophylls, how they are? So when you take the longitudinal section of these cones or strobilus, you can observe what kind of spores are seen in each leaves. On the each leaves, how the sporangium are, so everything you can understand. So when we take the longitudinal section of the cone, see here, this is the longitudinal section of the cone in Lycopodium. So in Lycopodium, since it is homosporous, example for homosporous means only one type of spores it produces. See here, it produces microspores. See here, this is microsporophyll. This is microsporophyll, which contains a sporangium, and this sporangium consisting of spores, and these spores are called as microspores. Okay, see here, this is microsporophyll. Such kind of many microsporophylls are here. Why these are called as microsporophylls is because they contain a sporangium which contains microspores, very small spores. If the same leaf which contains, so this is the sporangium which contains larger spores, these are called as what? Megaspores. Megaspores. Okay, megaspores, microspores as well as megaspores. Such kind of two types of spores are borne on the leaves, and those leaves are said to be as either microsporophylls or the megasporophylls. Right? So one thing we should clarify here, what is that? Microsporophylls as well as megasporophylls are respectively producing the gametophytes. Why? Because spores which come out of the sporangium and grow into new individual, then automatically, so these spores which produce the gametophytes. So why? Because we know alternation of generation over here. The dominant phase of these plants is sporophytic plant, and next one is gametophytic plant, which is independent one, photosynthetic one, right? So like this. So let us see here microsporophylls, which we are microspores. These microspores which develop male gametophyte, which produce male gametophyte, and megasporophyll which produce megaspores, and these megaspores which produce what? Automatically you will understand, female gametophyte, right? Female gametophyte is produced by the megaspores, and male gametophyte is produced by the microspores, which are respectively produced in megasporophyll as well as microsporophyll. So these facts should be very clear to you people. Okay, so now here in cone only one kind of spores are produced, hence it is said to be as homosporous. Example is Lycopodium. And if the same cones in which two types of spores are produced, see here, so if it is like this, one sporangium which contains larger spores, megaspores, one sporangium which produce microspores, the condition is said to be as what? Heterosporous condition, right? So these two are very clear to you, I hope so, right? So and the next one, gametophytes which are developing from the homosporous species. If they are produced or developed from homosporous species, they are being monoecious. I have already cleared what is monoecious condition. This is nothing but bisexual condition it is known as. What it is known as? Bisexual condition. If the gametophytes which develop from heterosporous species, then what it is said to be as dioecious. Dioecious condition. Dioecious in the sense that unisexual. Here unisexual means either male or the female. So this is the fact. So homosporous species, they are always being monoecious. Heterosporous species, they are being dioecious. The point to be noted. So it is very important point to be noted. Okay, so this is one fact. And I told you here spores which develop into gametophytes, and that gametophyte which is microscopic one, multicellular one, microscopic, multicellular, photosynthetic, thalloid, right? Thalloid gametophyte is called as prothallus. Very important point to be noted. So what is that? Spores which develop into new individual is gametophyte, and this gametophyte is green photosynthetic, green photosynthetic, microscopic, multicellular thalloid gametophyte is called as prothallus. What it is called as? Prothallus, which is microscopic one, and that prothallus is nothing but it is gametophyte, and it is independent photosynthetic one, and so it is microscopic thalloid in nature, and such kind of gametophyte which produces male sex organ as well as female sex organ, right? What are male and female sex organs? Antheridium, archegonium, right, are produced over here, and male sex organ produces male gametes, and female sex organ produces female gamete. Okay, and male gamete is so flagellated one. It is flagellated one, means it is provided with flagella. Many number of flagellas are there. With the help of flagella, it swims very actively in the water and comes towards the archegonium and enters into the archegonium, and ultimately it fuses with a female gamete, right, where the zygote is formed. See here, these two gametes are here, and these two gametes fuse themselves, right? Gametes fuse to form zygote, okay? And this zygote grows into embryo, right? It grows into embryo. And one thing should be very clear, that in female gametophyte, only in female gametophyte where the fusion and so male and female gametes take place, where the zygote is developed, and this is the precursor stage of seed habit, right? So what is that? So this embryo is there. This embryo develops into new individual. Okay, and this new individual will be once again sporophytic plant.
See here, so male sex organ, female sex organ are produced by the prothallus or the gametophytic plant, and they respectively produce male and female gametes, and both are fused in the female gametophyte only, right? So fusion of male and female gametes take place in female gametophyte, in a female gametophyte only, right? I have cleared here male gametophyte as well as female gametophyte, right? Female gametophyte is here, so which are respectively produced by the megaspores as well as microspores. Okay, female gametophyte, this is the precursor stage of seed habit. Means it shows the seed habit condition, but the seed is not produced in these plants. It is the previous stage of the seed formation. It is the precursor stage of the seed formation, which is seen in these ferns, right? So this is the fact what you should be very clear with. Okay, so precursor stage of seed habit it is. So this point to be noted over here, it is very important point to be noted. Okay, so these are the characteristic features of what? Pteridophytes. Now we'll start with the classification of pteridophytes. Pteridophytes are classified into four groups. Pteridophytes are classified into four groups: Cyclotopsida, Lycopsida, Spinopsida, and Pteropsida are the four groups these pteridophytes are classified into. Cyclotopsida, best example is Cyclotum, right? Best example is Cyclotum. Lycopsida, best examples are Selaginella and Lycopodium. And Spinopsida, best example Equisetum, right? These are commonly known as horse tails. The plant body looks like that, hence it is said to be as horse tails. These are commonly known as. And Pteropsida, best example Orientum. These are commonly known as ferns, right? Dryopteris and Pteris, Marsilia, Marsilia. See here, Orientum, Dryopteris, Pteris, Marsilia. So these are the best example for Pteropsida. So they are commonly known as ferns. Here Orientum, whenever you observe the plant body, at moment consider this is the plant body. Right? So rhizoids are present over here. This is the plant body. When this branch touches the ground, it strikes the roots over here, I mean rhizoids over here, and there also it makes a new plant body like this. Hence, this Orientum is commonly known as walking fern. What it is commonly known as? Walking fern. Like this.
So different examples we can take over here for respective group of the plants. Here first group of these plants are also known as whisk ferns, and these Spanopsida are commonly known as horsetails, right? So like this, common names are different one. Lycopsida is commonly known as club mosses, right? These are called as club mosses. This way the common names are different. Club mosses, these are called as whisk ferns, these are called as horse tails, these are called as ferns, these are called as. So like this, different common names are there for these plants.